All right, everybody, welcome to the Nostalgia Trap. I am your host, David Parsons. Got a special throwback episode for you today. This is actually a recording of a podcast that's kind of a lost David Parsons podcast. Way before the Nostalgia Trap, I had a show called Topical Fever. There are a few episodes surviving online, if you can find them, including lots of episodes with me and Justin talking through our insane political economy stuff that we've taken to the Nostalgia Trap. So the reason why I wanted to share this episode is about The Sopranos. It is the 20th anniversary of the Sopranos premiere. The Sopranos, I think, is in the air right now. A lot of people are rewatching the show. I think HBO is rerunning it. To me, like, The Sopranos is just a towering achievement. I probably use that word, towering achievement, in this podcast episode. But to me, it's just a really important text, and a really important text for understanding, you know, late 20th and 21st century American life, particularly life under this version of capitalism. It's a brilliant show, and we have lots to say about it. The conversation I had is with Jeremey Cagle, who's a professor of English, and we, as I recall, relate a lot of The Sopranos to another big American text, epic American text, Herman Melville's Moby Dick. So if that interests you, take a listen to this conversation. I hope you enjoy it. And we are retooling and bringing you new episodes of The Nostalgia Trap starting next week. So look out for those. Thanks, as always, for listening to the show. If you can subscribe to our Patreon, it would make us so happy. You know, these winter months are lean, and we're trying to make this program the best it can be. So if you can help us out, that would be great. You do that at patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. And really, if you just go to nostalgiatrap.com, our producer Peter Sabatino does a great job of those images and all the stuff that's cataloged on our website. So if you go to nostalgiatrap.com, you can find everything you need for the podcast. All right. So here is an old episode of Topical Fever. I hope you enjoy it. This is our analysis of a wonderful program and an important one, I think, to understand, The Sopranos. This week, we're going to do some adventurous thinking about pop culture. Some of you who listen to the show might be thinking, what the hell are you talking about pop culture? Are you going to start reviewing movies now? I thought this was political. I thought we were saving the world here. I want to talk about climate change and economic collapse and Occupy Wall Street. But if you're paying attention, the theme of this show, of Topical Fever, is it's all connected. And with pop culture, I certainly feel like pop culture is a very, very useful lens for us to realize both the nature of the problem and perhaps the way out. So yes, we are going to talk about pop culture today. A little bit about where I'm coming from. I mean, I don't want to bore you with a lot of high academic theory. But those of you who know me know that I studied film and media a lot, both as an undergrad and in graduate school. And you can't help but come across some of the more esoteric, arcane, out there, philosophical, cultural theory type stuff. And I'm talking about, like, you know, the hard stuff, the ridiculous stuff, the Judith Butler, the Jacques Derrida, the Michel Foucault, and all of that stuff. I mean, I read it, I liked it, I enjoyed it, and it was really fun to engage with very, very difficult texts like that. But I wouldn't say I became like many of my colleagues, especially in media, but I guess in English and history too. I never became a real theory head. I never became someone who really talked the language and became someone who spoke in constant polysyllabic words and took on a very confusing kind of postmodern academic identity. That wasn't me. I was always kind of more grounded. Maybe that's as a result of me being in history and studying kind of very grounded things like the Vietnam War. However, I must say, the theory stuff, as much as I, you know, never was a big fan of becoming a theory person, at the same time, those cultural theories are really, really important to me. And there were a few that I just want to mention that I think are particularly resonant for me that may explain a little bit of where I'm going with all this pop culture, and particularly with our discussion today with The Sopranos. One of them is a piece by a theorist named Siegfried Krakauer. The piece is called, the book is called From Caligari to Hitler. And it's a very famous film studies piece, and all it basically argues is that if you look at film. If you look at a nation's cultural output with regard to film, and I would say eventually television. Obviously, this book was written a long time ago. But if you look at film, if you look at the cultural output of a nation, particularly when it comes to the popular cultural output of a nation, you can kind of glean the unconscious motivations and fantasies of that nation. So you can figure out what is going on in the subconscious of that nation in that particular historical moment. And Krakauer, for him, he was interested in the so-called Weimar period of German history, in which the kind of interwar period between World War I and World War II. He was interested in the kinds of films like Nosferatu and The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari and Metropolis and M and all those kinds of Weimar era German films that provoked an incredible reaction in the film community because they were such striking films. For Krakauer, those films offer like a really, really important lens into German society, and particularly German society in this period, this very, very dangerous, weird, an important period in which German society came to terms with and began developing into the Nazi regime. So it's really that essay kind of showed me how you could read film and you can read pop culture to kind of glean what's going on underneath the surface of the society that produced that piece. So you can look at, for instance, the popularity and the production of torture porn films during the Bush administration, like Saw and Hostel, etc., as reflecting a particular anxiety or a particular coming to terms with the torture issue. That's just one example, but there are a lot of ways to read the underlying ideology of the national consciousness through pop culture, and so we'll be doing a little bit of that today. The other one that I wanted to mention that I thought had a big effect on me was Roland Barthes, B-A-R-T-H-E-S, Roland Barthes' The Death of the Author, very, very famous essay, kind of like the foundation of a lot of postmodern thought. But really, all The Death of the Author says is that the author and the text, the film, the TV show, the novel, are two separate things. They're unrelated, that we can't, we don't get a lot of use out of just looking at the author and trying to figure out what the author intended. Instead, it kind of liberates the author and liberates the critic, certainly, from looking for authorial intentions, and instead just kind of reading the piece for what it is. What that means for me is that when I look at something like The Sopranos, and I'll talk about The Sopranos in a second, I feel like The Sopranos was not made by David Chase. The Sopranos was made by the United States at the end of the 20th century. In the same way that Saving Private Ryan is not a Steven Spielberg film, it's a film that was produced by the society. And the society created a kind of operating system and a set of cultural possibilities and expressive and aesthetic possibilities under which each author must work. And so that kind of heady stuff is what filters into this conversation that I have with Jeremey Cagle about The Sopranos. Jeremey is also a professor of literature, someone who is one of my favorite adventurous thinkers. I feel like whenever, especially about pop culture and about literature and art, whenever I'm willing to go out on a limb into some adventurous thinking of what something might mean, Jeremy is right there with me with an example from, you know, The Last Boy Scout or an action film from the 80s or in the case of The Sopranos, Moby Dick. He has an incredible range of knowledge about an incredible range of works of art and literature. And we had a great conversation about The Sopranos. The Sopranos, you know, we had a long conversation, so I don't want to preface it too much. But I do want to say that, you know, Sopranos stands out for me in a lot of different ways in terms of providing that kind of lens into the national consciousness at a very, very important moment in the nation's history. And it's a big work. And I think as a big work, as a giant masterpiece, I think that it makes sense to compare it to something like Moby Dick, which is another huge piece of art that kind of describes the United States at a particularly transformative or transitional moment. And so this conversation between Jeremy and I will hit on a lot of the parallels between what Melville was doing and what Moby Dick was about and kind of the thematic possibilities for The Sopranos. The Sopranos amazes me because there are 88 episodes of The Sopranos. That means that someone at some point, and imagine this Hollywood pitch meeting, me saying to you, I want to make a movie, a series of movies. It'll be about one family, a gangster thing. It'll be Italian American gangsters. And in this series is going to be very artful. I'm gonna do it very seriously. It's gonna reference Goodfellas a lot of classic gangster stuff. But it's also gonna attempt to do something new and bring the whole gangster genre into the 21st century. And also, I'm not going to make one or two or three of these. I'd like to make 44, because if you think about 88 1-hour episodes, there's 44 2-hour movies. No one would think that you could do this, that you could actually produce 44 movies that are all going to be good. But somehow The Sopranos pulled it off. And I know that HBO has a tremendous amount of money behind them, but they also have a tremendous amount of creative talent that put this together. And The Sopranos ends up being a really big piece of American art that I think has to be come to terms with in one way or another if we're going to understand where we are and, like I said, the nature of the problem, the nature of American ideology and consciousness right now can be seen in Tony Soprano and can be seen in the same way in perhaps Captain Ahab and the Whale. So Jeremy and I had a really fun conversation. I hope you enjoy. Oh, and I almost forgot to mention that there should be a huge spoiler alert at the front of this episode. Jeremy and I discuss pretty much everything that happens in the show, including the very, very controversial ending. So, if that's something that you haven't figured out yet or don't know anything about and you don't want to know anything about it, then go ahead and watch the episodes and listen to this later. Okay, here's me and Jeremy. So I'm not usually one to fall for media hype, but I swear that I always had kind of an interest in watching The Sopranos, but I never watched it. And I never watched it until the final season, when everybody was talking about it as if it was going to be the biggest ending in television history. And I thought to myself, well, I'd kind of like to be in on this. And I kind of fell for the hype, but the hype ended up introducing me to one of what's become one of my most enduringly favorite pieces of television or art or media ever produced. The Sopranos has become kind of an obsession for me. And I know, Jeremy, you came to this late too, right? You came to it even later than I did. You just finished this.
I came to it very late, and in a way I'm glad I did, because I could kind of enjoy the series sort of all alone in my own little world.
And
you
don't have to share it with the
I didn't
yeah,
have to share
else,
it with anybody.
Right?
And I had heard so much about it. And about the ending, and I didn't know anything about the ending.
That shocked me, actually.
You know what I thought, David? I thought they went to jail at the end. Yeah. I really did.
You thought it ended like Seinfeld.
I thought it ended, I swear to God, because the thing was that I was not a big Seinfeld fan.
Right.
And I know I'm going to be crucified for that, but
I don't think necessarily. I think there are a lot of non-Seinfeld fans.
I didn't really
there.
Like yeah. the show. I found the show very depressing. And I knew that the ending of Seinfeld was the big deal, and it was around the same. It was a little later than that, right? And everybody was talking about The Sopranos in the same way that everybody was talking about Seinfeld, right?
Yes.
And it was like these were the two big endings,
and big because they were considered disappointing for for everyone.
Right. And I just had that feeling.
Even though I would argue with both Seinfeld and Sopranos that you shouldn't be disappointed. They're actually
fine
endings for the program.
Really, I don't know about the Seinfeld. I know that in Seinfeld they do go to jail, and but you know. I didn't know anything about The Sopranos, and I agree with you. There's no reason to be disappointed with The Sopranos ending, not at all. In fact, I was really pleased.
Yeah, and we'll get to the ending right. as we continue here,
as we spoil the series.
Yeah, we're gonna spoil the whole series. Well, I mean that's part of it for me. Is like I don't really care about the spoilers. I think I knew a lot of the big plot points. I knew a lot of the characters that were gonna go. I knew about the big pussy thing. And I knew about Adriana. I knew those were like the big turns. And it didn't bother me because for me, it's like that's just really one part of the plot points are just one part of an overall piece, right? So many ways you get there that are surprising.
Well, that's the thing, David. I thought that the series was really just about gangsters. And, you know, I had seen Goodfellas and all that kind of stuff. And I like gangsters and I like gangster stories and narratives. But I had no idea that the series was so much more than that, and that the narrative arc of the series was so huge and so comprehensive in a way, and worked on so many different levels that, like you say, I mean, the plot points of the story, it's sort of, I mean, you know, we'll talk about how this relates to a narrative like Moby Dick. And we know that, you know, the plot points in Moby Dick as well, it's about whalers and Captain Ahab, and, you know, it ends badly for them and so on. But,
right.
But it's not a book about whaling. I mean, it is, but it's not. Just as, you know, The Sopranos is not really about gangsters in a way. Right.
Yeah. And I think that's maybe one of the most important points to make about The Sopranos is it's not a gangster series in a sense. It uses the mafia as the central metaphor to explore something much larger. And in the same way that, you know, Ahab and the Whale is really a story about America. The Sopranos makes it actually pretty overt. I mean, the last season was heavily promoted on, you know, buses here in New York City and everywhere around the nation. As Made in America was the catchphrase, and it was the name of the last episode. Was Made in America, and there are hints throughout the series that the show is engaging deeply with the American experience over the mafia experience. In other words, it would much rather analyze Americans than analyze Americans in the mafia.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, in addition to that, being an American story and analyzing Americans, the series itself to me is an apocalyptic story.
Yeah. What do you mean by that? How are you defining apocalyptic? Because when we've talked about apocalypse on this show before, and we always think about, you know, zombies rising from the dead and the end of the world. But how are you thinking about apocalypse? Because I heard you say that you thought that Moby Dick was an apocalyptic story, and I was intrigued by that because I didn't remember, like, you know, in my head I was like, did the whale attack New York City and eat the Statue of Liberty, or did I miss something? What's apocalyptic about these stories?
Well, I think, you know, when we think about both of these narratives, we want to start with the idea of microcosm. Okay. And I know that, you know, we haven't heard that term since high school, but I think it's extremely relevant in these two stories where we talk about the microcosm, that is to say a miniature version of, you know, a universe of sorts. And
a way of representing much larger things in a kind of condensed form.
Absolutely. And, you know, with Moby Dick, for example, we want to think of the historical moment which it was produced and published, you know, with lots of really troubling things, and David, I'm sure you're well aware of this, happening at the time, such as, you know, the Compromise of 1850. We're still talking about Indian Wars. We're still talking about, you know, annexing land from Mexico. We're still talking about the specter of slavery in America.
These are ripe times in the middle of the 19th century. incredibly transitional moment. It's rapid industrialization, but it's happening in the context of this new nation being born and being conquered from the people that lived here at the same time that slavery is becoming a political issue. Yeah,
which makes it a perfect time for Melville to create this story where he's asking us, who are we going to be during this moment of transition with all of these things at our feet? What's our thinking going to be?
Yeah.
And what is, in essence, what is our responsibility to the future and to the past? And, you know, Moby Dick is a book obsessed with the past, as The Sopranos, I would argue, is also obsessed with the past and obsessed with endings, obsessed with death and the kind of, you know, inheritance that we have in terms of fate.
When you say obsessed with the past, I love that about The Sopranos. And actually, your Moby Dick thing is kind of chilling when you're thinking about a moment of transition. And if Moby Dick is an exploration of what kind of people are we, what kind of human beings and society and civilization are we building, then it's kind of chilling to think of The Sopranos as asking us the same questions.
Well, let's think about, I mean, with Moby Dick, of course, our ship is the Pequod, which is named after a Connecticut Indian tribe that was exterminated in 1637.
Mm.
Okay, that's where our microcosm takes place. And what Melville is going to do is show us that these patterns are repeated throughout history. You know, there is, you know, as Faulkner put it, you know, the past is never dead. It isn't even past, right?
Right.
There is a kind of, you know, continuance, a historical contingency. We live in a certain moment where, you know, we are continuing in other footsteps in a way, right?
Yeah.
And so Melville will show us that, you know, the Indians used to hunt whales too. The Indians were here too. Mm-hmm. And look what happened to them, right? And when the sailors board the Pequod, which again was named after an Indian tribe that was exterminated, the guys who own the boat and who are hiring the crew do this in a wigwam, a teepee.
Yeah.
And so, and there's an Indian in the crew. He's on, you know, Ahab's boat, Tashtego. And It's just like he's telling us over and over again that what we are is nothing new.
Yeah, and I mean, and that
as an empire, and that, in a that, sense, right? That, and the decisions we're making, these aren't new decisions.
Not at all. And the continuity of the
of thought in a way.
Yeah, and the continuity of the Indian thing throughout American history as a kind of central metaphor. I mean, it's amazing because it's like almost offensive that the Indian thing becomes a metaphor rather than a living people. But you know, I'm thinking about the Williamsburg hipsters that Justin and I talked about last week, wearing the Indian headbands as a fashion statement now.
Right.
But also I'm thinking about the fact that, you know, in the news right now there's a viral thing. I don't know if you saw it, about like they just opened a 100-year time capsule up in Oklahoma, in a small town in Oklahoma, and it was from 1913. And when they open it up, inside is a bunch of, you know, artifacts from the past. And it's amazing because it's written in this, like, you know, old kind of script that says, you know, to the people of 2013, and it's really addressed to us. But one of the things many of the things that they chose to include to represent their time in 1913 Oklahoma were like Indian artifacts.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, and it was kind of like clear that the people of Oklahoma in 1913 were much closer to real Indians than real Native Americans than we are,
right?
And so it's amazing that how that functions, and how it seems like this. It's often cast as this relic of the past, but it's very, very, very close to us.
And you know, allows us to think about our own future,
mm-hmm.
and about how we too will be a relic of the past,
right?
And these decisions that we make are important. And I mean, we think about The Sopranos, and we think about a family, right? The Italian American family in that great episode, Commendatore,
mm-hmm.
From I think season 2 or 3, I'll have to check here in a second, when they travel back to Italy in order to, you know, kind of go back and make that connection with the old world.
Right.
Well, that episode is amazing because you really get a sense of how deeply invested in history the show will be, in the sense that, you know, when Tony is back in Italy, and, you know, Polly's great in this too, but, you know, he meets with his female counterpart there, and, you know, they have discussions about business and about buying and selling cars.
That's right.
And then at one point she takes him.
That's the stuff I forget. There's like such a huge show. So much happens.
It's amazing.
I love that you're reminding me of this.
Well, she takes him. They take a little field trip, right? And it's very important where they go. They go to a cave, which was where the Sibyl or the Oracle used to be.
Mm.
And, you know, we're talking about fortune telling here. We're talking about fate and destiny. And, you know, Tony says something like, well, I thought that was a Greek thing. You know, they were in Delphi. And you know, the woman says that, well, it was. And then it was Roman.
Right.
And then after us, there will be someone else. And, you know, she's reminding us, really, I think the show has a lot to say about empire.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Tony, and she says, do you want to walk into the cave? And they go into the cave, and she then functions as the Sibyl for the Oracle for Tony. And what this is pointing to is not only, you know, the roots of, you know, Roman history and Greek history, but it's specifically pointing to an ancient text, Virgil's text, the Aeneid, where the soldier Aeneas, fleeing from, you know, burning Troy with his father Anchises on his back, you know, representing this kind of burden of history, you know, he will eventually found Rome. Well, he travels to that same cave, right, and meets the Sibyl there, and she takes him down to the underworld, where then he will see, you know, his future descendants and the greatness of Rome that is to be if he lives up to his destiny.
Mm.
Okay, so we're making all these connections, right? Because Tony is Italian, right? So his roots go back to essentially the Trojan War, right?
Yeah.
And so the destiny that he receives, or the future that he receives from the Sibyl this time, the advice that he gets is this: you are your own worst enemy. Like that's it's not that, you know, this is going to end well and, you know, your family is going to be super successful,
or even that your enemy is external and can be vanquished,
right? There's not, in fact, just the opposite.
Yeah,
right
you can never vanquish without extinguishing yourself.
And so what does that tell us about, you know, if we are talking in terms of a microcosm and we are talking in terms of an American empire,
and I'm thinking in terms of a mirror on our own kind of position, right?
That the
Sopranos offers us a kind of really razor sharp reflection that both clarifies and abstracts the major kind of social, political, psychological issues of our time.
It is a mirror, just like you say, through, in a sense, a lens of some kind of an alternative lifestyle, right? As the, you know, that famous essay by Robert Warshaw, the gangster is, you know, tragic American hero.
Right.
Where the gangster is this alternative to, like, you know, the happy American, yes, yes, yes. The gangster is no, no, no.
Right.
It's this, like, this imaginary construction of an alternative. And that's Tony, right?
And strangely, he's also, like, as much as that gangster is a no, 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 I think it's also made clear how there is no. There is no escaping. Like, it's almost, I mean, I don't want to get, like, super theoretical, but it's really about like, the hegemony of capitalism, in a sense, because it's basically the gangster. And I say this because I just watched Goodfellas, which is, as you mentioned earlier, is kind of the Quran for David Chase, the source story and source material for so much of the aesthetic and even the actors and everything else that the Sopranos became is based off Goodfellas. And in that movie makes it very clear that these guys are they're hyper-capitalists that are basically taking the tools of capitalism and just expressing them in a more, I guess, overtly street or violent way. But really, you know...
Well, what does Empire want?
It's just like the scene, I'm thinking of like a, fuck you, pay me. Pay me. And there's something about like the gangster that is like, oh, I admire this guy because he's like... He's a corporation without all the bullshit.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, it's like we still admire the corporation for this. Take it. And it's really...
That's part of our psyche.
It's romanticized in the movie, but it's also, I think, Scorsese is very much judging it. But either way, like, Ray Liotta's character at the beginning, it's one of the most, like, seductive parts of the whole movie where he says, like, we felt sorry for people that rode the subway every day and got up to their jobs because they were just suckers.
Right.
They had no balls. We saw what we wanted, and we just took it. And if anybody gave us any problems... They got hit so hard that they never gave us a problem again. That is extremely appealing to a lot of Americans, I think, and I think that's also being cast as a big problem.
Right. I think that's definitely part of his point, Robert Warshaw's. And if we think about, okay, well, with the Pequod and Moby Dick, obviously this is, you know, a journey that's going to end badly for the crew.
Right.
If this is the microcosm of America, and at this point of transition, and Melville's asking us, well, what kind of a perspective are we going to adopt from this point forward? And, you know, we can get into...
Is this why it's an apocalypse story?
Yeah,
Because it's basically the end of one world and the transition into another.
I think so.
And we don't know what it's going to be.
Well, we don't know what it's going to be, but we're given a series of choices.
I finally get the apocalypse reading now.
Right.
And I like it.
And so Ahab will represent a certain kind of thinking, a certain kind of action.
Mm-hmm.
And Ishmael, of course, will represent an alternative. And so, you know, Melville is going to put us right there on the boat, and he's going to ask us, which way are we going to go? Life, death, heaven, hell?
Right.
Where are we going to end up? Because if we choose the sort of Ahab style of thinking, this is going to bring us ultimately where we are right now, I think.
You know,
the kind of like Manichaean, us, them, you know, that kind of a thinking, that kind of an absolutist thinking is what Ahab is doing. And that's when we get to stuff like, you know, the Cold War and game theory and all this other kind of stuff. That's where we end up, right?
And so you have like presented in Moby Dick and presented in Sopranos, I think, pretty brilliantly, is like it's obviously the main character is Tony Soprano, but all the characters kind of experience this to some degree, is the offering of other paths, the offering of, like, they you can glimpse other ways out, but there doesn't ever seem to be a way out for any of the characters.
Well,
there's like there's a central kind of identity they're stuck in that even though they can glimpse and long for that way out and see that alternative life that you're talking about, that other direction that things could go. And I'm thinking about they never quite touch it. And that, I mean, that becomes really, really clear if you watch the series, especially towards the end when Tony is shot and is in the hospital.
Yeah.
They make a lot of kind of the other life that he could have lived, even to the point of like filming a whole kind of dream sequence with him existing in an alternate universe
in which
he's not named Tony Soprano. He's named Kevin Finnerty, and he doesn't have his accent anymore.
And I think that's another great connection that we can make to Moby Dick in terms of like, you know, Melville is telling us about the spiritual and the material.
Yeah.
Right. And a lot of the book has to do with the kind of duality of man and a duality of the universe. And the fact of the matter is that as Melville points out, our society is far removed from the spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the book, he has this great metaphor of an oyster at the bottom of the ocean. And he's saying that we have it all wrong in terms of thinking about life and death. Maybe we need to rethink things in terms of the water above the oyster, the briny water, as he calls it, right? Because it's thick. We think that's very clear and as thin as air, but he's saying it's not. And what he's pointing to is that we are very much removed from a non-material existence.
And there are more barriers there that we've placed than we realize. To say that in a country that definitely in 1850 would have been pretty overtaken by religious fervor. And Melville and the Sopranos, I think, depict... They put up a barrier between spirituality and religion in a sense. I think both of them have a very cynical kind of attitude towards religion, that actually religion doesn't offer that spiritual way out
right.
as much
it,
as it
does
promises.
Function as a barrier.
Yeah.
Right. And like you say, I mean, there are multiple points in The Sopranos where, you know, we're given a glimpse into this kind of, you know, symbolic world of the dreams and so on. A kind of direct mystical experience
yep.
with, mm-hmm. you know, the non-material. And
I mean, this gets so, for those who haven't seen the show or those who have, I mean, this gets so overt, the direct mystical experience thing that I was, it's, I at the time when I was watching The Sopranos, and I would say I still am very interested in the psychedelic experience, the shamanistic experience, this kind of like non-ordinary reality, the Carlos Castaneda kind of stuff, you know, going off into the desert, seeing visions, or the jungle and seeing visions, or, you know, that kind of reality. And when I was watching The Sopranos and getting towards the end, I was thinking, God, this show is so kind of reminds me of all that stuff. And I was already kind of anticipating it. But then, to my shock and surprise and delight, in one of my favorite episodes and probably one of the most powerful episodes of the whole series, called Kennedy and Heidi, Tony goes to the desert and takes peyote. And it blew me away at the same time that it felt like it fit exactly with what the themes of the show were, which is like Tony finally tried or finally went to the indigenous, went to the desert and took the cactus buttons and had a Tony Soprano type peyote trip,
well,
in which he which ends with him saying, I get it, screaming to the sun.
In a way, I think that is the answer, in a way.
Yeah.
It's that kind of an openness to an alternate experience, to a more spiritual or mystic experience. And I think that's true with The Sopranos. Maybe that is the one, you know, he says, I get it. And that's part of what, you know, people talk about when they talk about, well, what does he get exactly, right? But I think that's more toward the answer. And definitely the answer for Melville is that kind of openness to a spiritual experience, because during that spiritual experience, it's about unity.
Yeah.
Right. More
yeah.
than it is about a kind of divisiveness that we'll see with other modes of thinking.
Like, and
we're not stuck in this trap.
Right. Right. And what's so brilliant about and really scary about that, about the whole peyote episode with Tony, is that Tony had been having gambling problems throughout that season. By gambling problems, meaning he kept losing. He couldn't beat this losing streak, and it was really causing destruction throughout his entire life. But then he murders Christopher, his nephew, basically his son, his protege, the guy that was the closest person to him. Tony just decides, in a very random, arbitrary and frightening way, to just take the opportunity to murder Christopher. And after murdering Christopher, he goes to Vegas to basically have sex with Christopher's ex-girlfriend and take peyote with her. And while he's on peyote, Tony walks down to the casino, and it's really like a central moment. I think one of the most central moments in the series is when he walks down to the casino high in peyote, and he puts a bunch of chips down on the roulette table, and he looks at the roulette table and he says, I get it now. He's like, it functions the same way as the universe. It's the same principle as the universe.
Chance.
And, yeah. And he starts putting down his chips, and he starts winning. And he wins something like $70,000 or $80,000 in like this. And he begins laughing. And he begins laughing after he whispers under his breath, he's dead. He realizes, in other words, that he connects the murder to his change of luck, and his understanding of the universe exists through the murder. And he realizes this while he's high on this drug. In other words, he misses the point entirely. And what does he get? He, at the end, I mean, I feel like he gets just the same kind of narcissistic buzz that he gets from everything else in a weird way. He gets off the hook. He lets himself off the hook, and that's what's so, so scary about that scene. It's such a weird interpretation of the of what we're talking about here is that engagement, that lack of engagement with the mystical experience, and that that often even missing the point of that mystical experience.
And then you see, you know, in terms of his family, like where this is going to end up, mm-hmm. you know, and I'm thinking specifically about Anthony Jr.
Yes.
And we think about like where he is in society, right? And we
so much great stuff is done with AJ.
Right. And we think about a movie, you know, like we had discussed the comedy. I mean, how different is AJ from the character in the comedy?
Mm.
Right? In terms of like if this is the end result, and you know, our children are supposed to be in essence an end result in a way, right? This is what we produce. Like what's being made here?
He's,
like where are we going? Where does
he's
this
just
lead?
A loafing kind of vapid kind of guy that ultimately tries to kill himself in one of the more painful episodes because Tony realizes that he has the same disease that he has, which isn't even, I mean, what would you say is wrong with these guys? Like if AJ and Tony are kind of meant to be the opposite ends of the same stick. They definitely do that a lot. There's that great episode after he tries to kill himself that Tony comes to the hospital and they play this song that's like Antonio, Antonio, and like this Italian song,
yeah,
very clearly matching the father and son. So what if you're a psychologist, what's wrong with these guys?
Well, many things,
yeah.
I would say, but
I mean, because I mean, I think that that's the answer to the series in a sense, in a weird way. It's like, what's wrong with these guys?
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, that's sort of how, you know, the series begins. He walks into a guy walks into a psychiatrist's office and says, "What's wrong with me?"
Right.
You know, I'm depressed.
And he's having panic attacks.
He's having panic attacks
out and doesn't
so
know why.
And again, you know, there are moments where he refuses to listen in a way. Right? He doesn't hear. And I think I don't know. Maybe part of the answer is art itself in terms of, you know, well, where can we find this, you know, connection to a non-material base, and maybe not through peyote, but through art maybe. And sort of, you know, this blurring between art and reality that we see oftentimes in the show. I'm thinking of, you know, specifically the episode where Tony's mother dies. And we begin with that, where they do this sort of meta thing with the film, and Tony's, you know, he's lying down in the kitchen because he just had a panic attack, and then they do the and it rewinds, and then you get to see that scene where he's really upset because Meadow is dating an African American.
Oh yeah,
right. And then later in the show,
and he sees the Uncle Ben.
Uncle Ben, right?
Rice.
That's why he passes out.
What a great thing about the American mind,
right?
Like the racist American mind that like sees the Uncle Ben, connects it to the black guy that's dating your daughter, and then passes out of a panic attack. Really, really ripe American historical material there.
Exactly. And the movie that Meadow is watching with her boyfriend is Public Enemy.
Yeah.
And later on, Tony will revisit that film and we'll see moments in that film that are essentially about his life.
Mm-hmm.
And it is through the film as he's watching it that he's actually able to connect with the reality of the situation of his mother's passing.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, moment by moment, as he watches different segments of the film, he becomes more, his emotional response changes. And by the end, he's actually, you know, crying.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like that, it is through the art, in essence, that he's able to really
see
his own life.
They do a lot of him watching TV and seeing,
they do a
yeah,
lot
watching
of that.
Him watching movies.
A lot of
him,
that.
I imagine Tony sitting on the couch, you know, in his suburban castle, kind of eating ice cream late at night, watching the History
yes,
Channel. He
watching
likes
the
to
History
watch
Channel.
A World War II documentaries. They certainly like have a lot of World War II stuff going on, which I love too.
Well, this is a series that time and time again makes these kinds of references to important art,
yeah.
And is very kind of self-aware that this is art, and that we are making connections not only, as I mentioned earlier, you know, to Virgil and some more maybe obscure references. But I mean, the scene where Meadow, you know, talks about Leslie Fiedler's interpretation of Billy Budd, a Melville story.
Yeah, right.
It's like, obviously, these guys are Melville fans.
Yes.
Like, she's giving this great, you know, interpretation of, you know, this alternative reading of
you know,
story.
The fact that when, it, now that I...
And the Robert Frost, remember the Robert Frost poem?
Yeah, well, and think about AJ. He quotes, who's he quoting when he says,
Nietzsche?
Yeah, he says, what rough beast slouches towards?
Oh, yeah, Yeats.
Yeah. And he brings that up at Bobby's funeral. And everyone's like, what the fuck is wrong with you?
Time and time again, right? And then, you know, Anthony Jr. is also like, well, God is dead or whatever. And then Tony with that great line, I don't care if God is dead, you're still going to kiss his ass.
It's a great device that they put like both AJ and Meadow in college. And because they allowed them to explore issues that the parents would never explore. Do you remember AJ gets freaked out because it takes a course on Israel-Palestine?
Right.
And he goes to a psychologist and he's like, what the fuck is wrong with the world? And how can we live like this? And it actually drives him further into depression suicide to like learn about the world. That's actually a pretty, now that I think about it.
Well, at the same time, he's taking that poetry class where the teacher, like we see one scene in the poetry class and it's, you know, the world is too much with us.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, the famous line. And she's like, well, why is the world too much with us? And then the camera's on AJ's face and he's blank. Right.
I was talking to Claudia last night about Carmella, because they do this a lot with her. The glimpsing of the other world.
That's right.
And realizing how like myopic your lens is.
Right. Like, when she goes to Paris, for example.
Yes. Yeah. It makes me cry every time. There's something about it. I don't know what it is. Well, I know what it is. It's a lot of stuff about my own family and things like that. Kind of like glimpsing this other world, and I include myself, even that my feeling was, even coming to New York, was feeling this way, and looking at things and kind of feeling, Carmella sees old. She sees Parisian statues. She sees like the history
again,
and it just blows her away. She says, "Who could build this?"
Mm-hmm.
And they contrast it with her friend Roe,
right? Who doesn't get it at all?
Who's like Carmella? She's like that. She's kind of a materialistic suburban woman who's kind of like, who cares? But Carmella is blown away. I mean, it really, the look on her face is like the 1,000-yard stare of like the Vietnam vet, right? It's like, I've seen too much. And it's just, all she's seen is just a glimpse of the rest of the world.
Yeah.
She saw Paris. That's it. And it really lets you in on how small their worldview is and how like their values are constricted so, so narrowly.
Our values, right? As a country.
Yes.
And see, I think this is part of what the show is telling us too. Like, for example, Melville, you know, our great symbol in the novel is going to be water. Of course.
Yeah, right.
And you know, this, what Melville will call this ungraspable phantom of life.
Mm.
And in the show, I think obviously it's not water, but it's art in a way, right? You know, for Melville, he's saying you have to leave land. You have to leave those constrictions of land in order to allow yourself to be free. There's a certain kind of isolation that you need to be closer to God in terms of letting go of these constraints. Well, in The Sopranos, I think like part of that journey is going to be art.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is like, you know, really trying to embrace some of what's being done in art and the show itself.
Well,
is,
I think,
in fact,
that,
kind of like the show is art, and it knows it's art.
Right.
So the show is itself the answer in a way, right?
Which
is the very clever thing and especially when we get to the end, like this is
the
obviously,
art is the gateway.
Exactly.
Like,
the
art is the gateway into for us as human beings, all we have is that way, the central kind of form that we've created that we call art is just a word that we use to describe anything that takes us out of ourselves,
right?
Anything that kind of,
this is exactly what Melville is saying, though,
that kind of functions as a gateway into that non-ordinary reality,
right?
And a
non-material reality,
right? And
way,
and
right?
That's why I think that when you go to a museum and you see high school kids and you see, you know, and I don't want to pick on the high school kids, but everybody, and I include myself, just kind of like staring at the art and just kind of looking at it. They're not trying to have, and the reason they're not like enjoying themselves often, or not quote unquote getting it, is I think often the result, and I include myself on this, of not like releasing yourself into the art. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You're like looking at it as just like a piece. You're looking at it in a very kind of physical way.
You're looking at the window instead of through the window.
Hey, there you go. You're not jumping into it with your mind and allowing it to kind of like fill in all those spaces that you keep closed.
Because it does work on a kind of, it has a kind of symbolic language.
Uh-huh.
Just as literature works in a symbolic language, just as, you know, as we see in the series, like
you have to open up parts of yourself,
exactly,
to understand it that aren't usually open.
That's right. And again, like we see this oftentimes in the dreams and the dream sequences in the series, But there's that barrier. Like, Tony can't actually figure that out.
Yeah, we just talked about that actually with the Indian thing, right?
Yeah.
As kind of a one of the metaphors of it's employed throughout actually all the HBO shows. I don't know about Six Feet Under, but I'm thinking of like Deadwood and Boardwalk Empire have certainly like weave the Indian stuff throughout throughout their kind of thematic arc. But I was thinking about when Tony is in the hospital in that final season, the last season, someone leaves a piece of paper that they pin onto a bulletin board close
to him. His sister,
wasn't
it?
Well, she denies it though. She's like, okay. She says, I didn't do it.
Okay.
And his sister definitely is the hippie. I want to get to that in a second,
yeah.
But, cause she represents the kind
of
like
California bullshit.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Someone put this old Navajo saying, right? This quote that says, you go about in pity for yourself, but all the while a great wind carries you across the sky. Something
right,
like that, right?
Right?
And
which is perfect.
Yeah, and Tony, for a second, this is like, he really, really gets that. And while he's in the hospital, because of his injury, and it's because he's close to the door of death, right? Because he's close to death, mm-hmm. he gets it for a second in a way that he doesn't get it when he's on peyote.
Yeah.
He gets...
Which, as you said, we also connect that to a kind of, you know, indigenous Native
right,
American.
Right, right. So he gets that knowledge and he takes it. But then, as we talked about, like as Tony gets better and as he gets further away from the door of death and he heals and
yeah.
he gets out of the hospital, he continues to use that phrase.
Right.
But he employs it in a way that's like aggressively attacking people. He says, like... You go out and pity for yourself.
It like, becomes a weapon
you.
For him.
You
right?
go out and pity for yourself. And
yeah.
he forgets, crucially,
mm-hmm.
the second part, which is you're carried by a great wind across the sky.
Yeah.
That part of him, the spiritual part,
yes.
the, what other people would call God, the that aspect of it, that non-ordinary reality has been excised by Soprano as he moves forward and he only uses the first worldly phrase. In other words, his foot is firmly in the world that he's kind of trapped.
His mother was the same way too, right? I mean,
right. She wished for death all the time, right?
She wished yeah. for death. And
I wish the Lord would take me now.
Yeah, and yeah. when she's talking about it, I don't remember if she was talking to Anthony Jr. She was talking to Tony. She says, you know, well, it's all a big nothing anyway. What, you know, what are you going to do about it? It's all a big,
oh, and it's
all a big nothing.
You know, it fucks with AJ.
Yeah.
Because he's like, he says that to the psychologist. It's like the first thing he says is to the psychologist is like, when I was talking to my grandma once, she said, it's all a big nothing. And there's the impact of that has on a kid,
right?
To hear an adult just tell you basically you're never going to learn anything more than what you know now, and it's always going to feel like it's always going to feel empty.
Yeah,
is a really really yeah. horrible thing to put on a kid.
Yeah, there is only the superficial. And you know, I mean, that it's just it's perfect in the Navajo saying is perfect for that, right? And the fact that, I mean, they just don't, they can't get it at all.
Right, right.
And well, how do you get it? I mean, is this a show about, you know, art?
Yeah.
Is this a show about what?
I think for me, the art is like we said, it's like the central metaphor through which they explore the character's inability to really get it.
Yeah.
Really feel it. Like and the phrase get it is actually used several times. Like, you don't get it, you don't get it. Yeah, for me the show is asking us some very, very difficult questions. I think that maybe that's why the ending resonated so I guess poorly with a lot of people, is they were looking for some sort of closing or some sort of answer to it all. And can we...
Well, yeah, and again, I mean, this is
that,
a show...
I don't want to do, like, a close reading of the ending, but I would like to talk about, like, why... what happens there in that diner?
Well, a show that's, I think we can say, is obsessed with death on several different levels, right? I mean,
right.
If we think about the way that the show portrays death, no one gets away clean.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody dies a horrible death.
Right.
And you die of cancer.
Yeah, Johnny Sack is
yeah.
made. Yeah.
And even in, you know, there's one episode called The Happy Wanderer.
Didn't realize how much of a
wonderful allegory about fate and like the vicissitudes of fate.
What happens in The Happy Wanderer?
Well, in The Happy Wanderer, again, talking about how no one gets away clean, that, you know, Tony, there's one moment where he's talking to Melfi, Dr. Melfi, and it's a relative of his who was, as Tony describes him, like a really good man who always did the right thing. Mm-hmm. You know, he was one of these happy wanderers. The guy just walks around whistling.
Right.
And he was on his roof, like putting on Christmas lights or some shit like that. And a wind came along and blew him off.
Right, right.
And he died all of a sudden.
The great wind that the carries wind. You across the
yeah,
sky.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's just like there is no happy death in a way.
Yeah.
Like everybody is just
crushed. And Tony, you know, you only see him. That's what's so brilliant about the Dr. Melfi thing. You might think like, oh, it's the, and that's probably what I thought when I first, you know, came in contact with the Sopranos was like, oh, what a gimmick of the psychologist talking to the mobster. But it's actually a great way for Tony to express all those thematic kind of things. He is really angry at that kind of stuff. Like, how many times did you see him go like, I fucking hate this
shit?
Well,
David,
he can't handle it.
No, and I think
the introspection enrages us.
Well, I think all of that goes back to the fact that the characters in the series are so separated from any kind of spirituality or any kind of non-material existence, and for that reason, like, you know, death becomes this horrible thing for them, right?
Right.
Whereas if we look at
it, they can't imagine that it's anything. Because
it's all nothing.
Yeah, it's just right? Lights out.
Exactly. So literally, right? Yeah. If we're talking about the ending. But,
yeah.
But then we talk, you know, if you think about a series like 6 Feet Under, which very much, I think, you know, tries to and succeeds in domesticating death, right?
Yeah,
it
right.
literally is in the house with them, right? Yeah. All the time.
Yeah, honestly, well, I'm sure it'll be Claudia, but eventually I'll do a show about 6 Feet Under because, honestly, that show changed my attitude towards death more than any other
too.
Piece of art I've ever seen. It really
made
me. And that's what's a strange thing to be saying to me, to people that listen to this show, maybe that these pieces of work made by HBO, this huge, you know, multinational media corporation, is creating
interests are elsewhere.
Yeah, they're creating whose interests are elsewhere. There you go. Are creating pieces of art that I love, that I respond to, and that I think are actually really, really important in a way that's like I almost think that shows like The Sopranos and 6 Feet Under and even The Wire have not been praised enough. As much as they've been overpraised, I really feel at the same time we're kind of missing the point. If they really are like there's a lot of value in these shows, and they're asking us very, very challenging questions about some of the biggest issues that's facing I don't know, throughout American history. I would say I think that the shows definitely are engaging with a kind of American historical thing.
Well, definitely, and again, if you think about, you know, the historical moment Moby Dick being created, and then this really unique historical moment of The Sopranos, right?
Mm.
As the show, you know, bridges the 20th and 21st centuries.
And 9/11 happens.
And 9/11.
Yeah, and 9/11 actually became an overt part of the show too, didn't
right.
it?
Right.
Yeah.
And so, again, you know, we're at a transition period, and, you know, perhaps David Chase, you know, he's like Melville, asking us, where are we going to go now?
Right.
And I think that has very much a lot to do with the way that the show ends.
Mm.
And a show that is obsessed with death and is obsessed with endings in terms of, you know, kind of getting back to this apocalyptic tone that the show has, right? There is an end.
Yeah,
And
so, you know, the thing that pissed people off about the ending of the show is that that Tony goes to a diner. He listens. He's meeting his family members there. They're all kind of arriving separately, which I thought was important. And in the diner, it's kind of an unnotable thing. They're just kind of sitting there and they're eating,
right.
and Tony puts on the song "Don't Stop Believing" by Journey, which is exactly the kind of like white trash song that he would put on. And the song has a kind of, in the context of the diner and the context of the Sopranos show ending, creates an incredible tension in the scene with Meadow outside, the daughter kind of trying to park the car.
Yeah,
and ultimately,
brilliant
editing. At the peak of this kind of ultra tense song and scene, the screen cuts to black and silence, and that was it. And
well,
a lot of people checked their TVs. Did you think something was wrong?
I didn't.
You knew it blacked out like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah. But I could see how people would.
Yeah.
I knew something.
Watching it live, and the whole room freaked out.
We
all thought something was broken. I was having a heart attack.
Well, it's funny you say that. I mean, the ending is death.
What did you expect was going to happen when you were watching that scene?
I had no idea. I knew something bad. It felt like something bad.
Yeah,
like
right.
all the suggestions that something's bad, because Tony keeps looking up at the door and different guys coming in and so on and so forth.
And the dude that goes into the bathroom
wearing the members only jacket
yeah.
guy.
Right.
You know, of course, the reference to Godfather and so on, right? But, like, I see the ending as three different kinds of deaths. in a way. Probably most obvious, Tony's death.
Yeah.
Where clearly, perhaps not clearly, but I think it's suggested that this is Tony's point of view.
Yeah.
And this is, you know, consciousness shutting down.
Yeah. No, right? I agree. I think they made that kind of clear. I'm on the Tony got killed side of
this.
Yeah,
me too.
Particularly after David Chase gave the interview where he said, like, people say that the show ended ambiguously, but I'm telling you that there's an answer there.
Right. There is,
like,
an answer.
Yeah.
And I think the other death, obviously,
he got shot to death in front of his family.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And
that's what's awaiting Tony at the end of this, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
It's like Meadow coming in the door and seeing Tony's brain splattered all over the onion rings. Yeah.
And of course the other death, the death of the series, like, this is the final point here. It's over. And then I think the last death here is probably the death of the viewer.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. That's great. I like that.
I mean,
the show is that reflexive and meta to be able to, I think,
absolutely
be doing those simultaneous things. I mean, it really is a masterful ending of the show. I've watched it a million times. It sucks me in every time. And every time now I'm really upset at the ending. Not upset in a way that like I hated it. I'm upset that it really. Really throws it at you. I mean, talk about microcosm. They condense the whole series down to that sitting at that table. And many people forget, by the way, that AJ was going to be in the military.
Yeah.
Like, that was the last episode. Was, you know, people think about the diner, you know, the diner was the last episode.
But mostly
was about keeping AJ out of the military during the time when the Iraq and Afghanistan wars are going on. So that's, it's not like they just thought of that as a plot point for fun. You know, that plot point is very, very much engaging with, like you said, empire, right?
Yeah. And where will the American empire end?
And soldiers. I mean, mafia uses that, employs that language, right? The good soldier. Adriana and Christopher identifies as a soldier many times.
I mean, look at they're captains and lieutenants
yes.
and so on.
Like, yes.
There is a sort of, you know, social order that mimics
and,
a military.
Yeah,
order.
And yet Tony is completely repulsed that AJ would join the military,
right.
Which is kind of ironic considering AJ's like saying, "Dad, I'm like you. I want to join a hierarchical organization and I want to kill."
Yeah.
For money.
Right.
Right. I mean, and Tony is absolutely disgusted by that because it's nationalistic. It's weird. It's like Tony's. There's that gangster thing, right? It's like the killing and the crime and all that kind of like hierarchical bullshit. That's fine in our little organization.
Yeah.
But like when it's the FBI, they're the most disgusting people on the planet. Like they hate the FBI. I mean, the FBI is, and actually the FBI is portrayed as pretty shitty on the show.
Again, I think what the show also does is it really kind of subverts any sort of idea of absolute truth,
right?
And you know, even this idea of, you know, law and order, of course, like with the FBI guys, in one episode he's actually sort of turned to Tony's side and feeds him important information.
Yep, he gets Phil Leotardo killed.
Yeah, so
and you know what's great is when Phil Leotardo gets killed, he's like, they flash to that FBI agent. Do you remember? He's like in bed with his mistress.
Yes.
There's another FBI agent.
Yes,
and she says like just casually, she's like, "Oh, did you hear Phil Leotardo got whacked?" And he like celebrates. He's like, "Yes," and he says something like, "We're gonna win this one."
Yeah,
and it's just amazing
I think she gives him a weird look
something. That affinity between the FBI. And the mob, because they're really doing the same things. It's like we're gangsters, we're capitalism. That's what we are.
Right.
Like we're the force.
Yeah.
You know, we're the muscle of this enterprise. And the FBI, and they frequently show the FBI and Sopranos family and the mobsters looking at each other through a glass darkly. In a sense, they're like they're opposite sides of the same coin. Another kind of a nod to the inescapability of certain truths in America.
Well, and then, you know, I wonder where does this leave us, though?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we can think about the show in a number of different ways, but what's the antidote?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Because that's, to me, in a way, that's really what makes this show great art, right?
It might be peyote.
Well, we can try.
Yeah, I get it.
Yeah, right. Because, I mean, it's not just saying you're wrong, but it also, at the same time, it has to tell us that, you know, maybe we should be thinking about something else. Maybe we should be looking over here.
Right.
And I don't know if, and I think The Sopranos is trying to do that, and I don't know if many other shows are, for example. Like, you know, we often, when we talk about great shows in this golden age of TV, certainly, we talk about shows like Mad Men and Deadwood and Breaking Bad and, you know, several others.
Yeah.
But are those shows, I mean, what are they doing? Like,
I don't know.
I think The Sopranos really stands out.
That's for me too, and I don't want to be a snob about it. I know that there's a kind of arbitrary thing when it comes to like judging TV shows, and I don't like saying like this is the best. But at the same time, let's indulge in that for a second, because I really do think that The Sopranos is like one of the greatest works of art ever.
Right.
And you know, which can hold up with
we can talk about Melville and, you know, David Chase in the same sentence.
Right. And, you know, I just saw something the other day that was like kind of shitting on Breaking Bad. They're like, Breaking Bad is great, but it's really kind of, it's really just pop entertainment. It's not The Sopranos, where The Sopranos is like this high quality thing. And I certainly...
You were saying that? Or you
no, I wasn't saying okay. this. I read someone saying this. And I thought my immediate reaction was kind of like, well, that's kind of snobbish bullshit to say.
Yeah.
Because actually, you know, in a certain sense... I can sometimes say that Breaking Bad is on par with Sopranos and just in how intense it is in terms of its engagement with all these themes. And it also does so in a very, very different and creative kind of way. I mean, the show is more about like its form takes on a kind of particular resonance, but, the idea that one is better than the other isn't a particularly useful conversation, but at the same time, Sopranos is something, right?
Well, it, you know, a show about death.
Yeah.
I mean, in a show, like you said, you know, 6 Feet Under will have you thinking about mortality in a different way and your own life in a different way. Well, I think The Sopranos, I think, accomplishes that in a way too.
Yeah.
And I think that ending, especially, you can't walk away from that ending and not feel something about, like, now what?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I mean,
now what do I do with my life?
For me, one of the most painful things is the end of the ending of that show, because everything you got a lot on the penultimate episode, right? The episode before the last one was when all the shit went down, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's when there was like a lot of shootings and basically Tony's organization was proven to be rather inept at handling a real war. And one of the most painful moments is in the episode called The Blue Comet.
Yeah.
Which refers to this moment where this character Bobby, and I thought that Bobby gets killed in while he's buying a toy train. And he's Bobby is like this big lovable lug, right? He's like, even though you see him do shitty shit in the show, and he's kind of a mobster like everybody else,
he's got a heart.
Yeah, there's something about Bobby. I think that why do you think they made Bobby's death so prominent?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't know why.
I mean, I don't want to ask you like you're a student. Why don't you write an essay about that, Jeremy? Can you tell me?
I think Bobby, in a way, is similar to Big Pussy. Where like I kind of felt the same way about Big Pussy in a way, and when I say Big Pussy, we're talking about
the character that was killed in the second season, in another extremely memorable and painful death.
Yeah, and they were both kind of big lovable guys.
They were funny.
They were family guys.
Yeah, right. And they actually make quite a point at the end of Bobby never killing anybody. He had never killed anybody, and in an episode called Soprano Family Values, Tony
did not want to either.
Yeah,
right?
Tony makes it asks him about that, and Bobby's like, no, you know, I never have, and it's fine with me because I got kids now. And Tony, just to be a dick to Bobby because of a fight that they had at the cabin, Tony decides to make him kill somebody just to stain him. He like resents him so much that he was like, why don't you kill somebody and be like me, you know, be like, feel as shitty as I do. And the ending of that episode is heartbreaking because Bobby returns from having murdered somebody, and the murder he commits is like this really shitty thing. He has to like walk into this like really awful like laundry room and just like kill this dude that's just someone's boyfriend that's pissed someone off. It's really sad, actually. And Bobby returns to the lake after killing this person and losing his kind of innocence, and he picks up his kid, he picks up his little daughter, and that's how that episode ends. And there's something very, very profound about that, about not just killing, but about morality and family.
Yeah, there's a kind of, you know, a kind of toxicity.
Right. The show, disease.
The disease of it. And even though you might be a big, good-hearted family guy and you don't want to kill somebody, you're still part of this, and it will catch up to you.
Right, right.
And again, as the show works, it's going to catch up to you in a way that's going to be horrific.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's not going to end well. You're going to be looking at a train, thinking about your kid, and there you go.
Yeah, and those last killings. I mean, the show had
they're brutal.
They had a significant amount of violence on the show, but the last killings were done in a way that it was a lot of the two guys from Italy with the baseball caps wearing athletic clothes, and they dropped the guns. And I mean, it became like this really, really, this ritual that was so stomach turning. There was nothing romantic about these killings. There was nothing like, oh, cool, the mob is awesome. They felt like exterminations. It felt like, it almost felt like The Matrix, like these agents just appear out of nowhere while you're sitting in the mall, you know, at a toy shop, buying a train for your kids, and all of a sudden, they come out, and the editing of that scene is so masterful, because they really focus a lot on the witnesses, the people that are watching this, the other children that are in the toy store watching this guy get shot like 19 times in front of everybody. They do the same thing with the strip club, right? The guy gets run over in front of the strip club, and everybody's screaming. They focus really, really heavily on everybody watching the violence.
Right.
They do it with Phil Leotardo.
And not doing anything.
Phil Leotardo gets whacked, right? And it's the centerpiece. It's a centerpiece killing of the whole series, is that the last killing is Phil, who is the big guy, the main enemy. Tony finally catches up with him because the FBI gave him the tip. And Tony's guys assassinate him right in front of his wife. Yeah. While he's like talking about like picking up the pharmaceuticals, right? He's like, oh, I'll go to the pharmacy later and I'll pick up some orange juice or whatever. And all of a sudden, a gun just comes up to the side of his head and blows his brains out. And then his head gets run over by the car and everyone's puking and screaming.
Yeah.
And I mean, for me, that's one of the bigger.
It's so gruesome. And to watch that clip, and there's on YouTube, they just have his death as a clip because it's so
people,
awesome.
But people love it. Yeah.
People love it. And there's one guy who comes out of a car and he looks at and he goes, oh shit!
Yeah, right.
And I crack up every time I see that guy.
But isn't that kind of a signal of what how the show was going to end?
It's a signal
that Tony was going to get killed in the same way, right in front of his family. That killing of Phil takes place about 20 minutes before the diner scene.
Well, and then
at the end of the show,
and there's a
case closed, Jeremy. I'm sorry, we disproved it.
Yeah, right. And there's an increasing amount of talk. Remember, like with Bobby, also there's that talk that Tony has some really heartfelt moments where he's, Bobby's, and they talk about death in the show, right? And Tony's always like, well, you won't see it coming.
Yeah, it just goes black.
Yeah. And there are only two ways out of this
game.
They
even flash back to that scene when Tony when they quote unquote hit the mattresses, and Tony's you remember when Tony goes to bed on the mattress at the end with the machine gun, and it's there's nothing. Again, when they show Tony with the machine gun, you think like, oh, cool, Scarface, right? This is some Scarface shit. But wait, this is not cool at all. It's actually the most one of the most depressing moments of the whole show is Tony, after being like the king, having this suburban life, now he's sitting, in this shitty house. Is that his mother's house, by the way?
Yeah, it's his mother's house.
Well, Jesus Christ.
I wonder, if we come back and think about this show as a kind of microcosm or, an allegory or some kind of a representation of the society, I think that goes a long way in showing us these really gruesome murders. In terms of, I mean, is the show like Moby Dick asking us, we need to take responsibility for the history.
Right, right.
Right, and what we've done as an empire, as a country, right? And I think, what we have to do is nasty.
Yeah.
Right, in order to maintain the empire, there are some unjust things that need to go on, right? It is about aggression. It is about control. It is a kind of sexual appetite in a way. And if you look at, the sexual desire that runs through The Sopranos, it's completely twisted.
That hasn't come up.
It's completely unhealthy.
Is that, Tony's mistresses and the role that, I mean, the particular... I think David Chase definitely writes the woman characters on The Sopranos as even more constricted in the possibilities for their lives than the men.
This is a patriarchal system.
Carmela, Edie Falco's performance is dynamic and insanely fantastic.
Oh, yes.
as James Gandolfini.
In every way.
There's some stuff that she does that just blows your mind.
Yes.
She's just an incredible actress, but through her, she glimpses the other world. If you remember, through the David Strathairn character,
yes,
she leaves Tony for a season. She gets in shape, and they do this kind of like plot where Carmela is exploring a life outside of the mafia box that she's written herself
into. An intellectual life,
right? And again,
they're connecting
once again,
through
she's
literature.
Presented with Flaubert, right?
Right.
Madame Bovary.
Yeah.
And the show kind of makes fun of that guy. You know, he's like
a story which ends badly for her.
Right. There's a lot of the kind of like weepy, wimpy, liberal, intellectual dudes that show up on the show that are I don't think that that David Chase is necessarily making fun of those guys, although I wouldn't put it past him to make fun of those guys.
No.
The, like, wimpy intellectual guy. But like David Strathairn, the character that Carmela has an affair with, essentially. She was separated from Tony at the time, but she carries on with this guy for a little bit. She sleeps with him and everything. I mean, it was a big deal for her as a Catholic to even do that.
Yeah.
But
she becomes
also
Madame Bovary,
right?
In that, I mean, she gets carried away with the fantasy of love.
But it also it's something so like when she says Madame, he says Flaubert, and she doesn't know. She obviously doesn't know how to spell it,
right?
And she's writing it down, and she kind of says like, "Oh, I'll stop by Barnes and Noble and pick it up." And there's something like they're definitely making fun of her and him, and like, but in a sense, they're kind of showing how their worlds and their kind of intellectual engagement are incompatible.
Absolutely.
Like they it's not that like she's stupid and he's smarter. Mm-hmm. It's actually the show. I think they did her a favor in a sense, you know, by portraying him, David Strathairn's character, as this kind of like, I don't know, he's kind of wishy-washy loser kind of guy. And it shows that there's not one that's smarter or dumber. It's actually two different engagements with intellectual life that are not compatible. That Carmela comes from a world that she can't leave Tony. That's what's so amazing about when they get back together. Carmela's crying, and she's not crying because she's happy. She realizes that she could never, ever, ever leave her husband.
That's right. And she's given advice along the way, right? She goes to her own psychologist.
Yes.
And the guy's like, you know, the money that you're spending is dirty money.
Yep.
You need to get out. Your life is a lie.
And what's her answer?
Don't say you haven't
All
been told.
Money is dirty money.
Yeah, right.
And you know, there's a part of me that's like, hey, you know, there's a part of me like, right, you know, the anti-capitalist that's like, you know, she's got a point.
Yeah.
But on the same token, you know, if we're go back to what Justin said on the Hipster show about like people just like sucking off the society, the Sopranos are a loathsome family.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they make money by taking it. And then they don't. It's not like they take that, rob from the rich and give to the poor. They give to themselves. They have big houses, big cars, you know, just jewelry and ridiculous shit. And Tony even just gambles hundreds of thousands of dollars at a time. I mean, it's really piggish behavior. It's gross. It's gross capitalist behavior.
It is. And you know, in thinking about how we might, you know, as Americans, kind of fit into the series in a way, I think. I mean, are we Carmela?
Yeah.
In a sense of where we're okay with where this came from.
I think we're Tony.
We don't want to think about where this came from.
We're Tony, we're Carmela,
we're both, right?
Yeah, they've created like little archetypes
exactly.
of the American experience, definitely. And AJ is the young people, you know, as much as that's kind of like a ridiculous cliche.
Right.
AJ and Meadow offer like show us two different kind of ways. Like you fully understand that Meadow's going to be okay. You know what I mean? You fully understand that Meadow's got it figured out. Like, she's going to live a good middle-class liberal
and
life.
And that's why she wasn't sitting at the table at the end.
right. Yeah, that's great. She kind of gets out a little bit, but at the same time, she doesn't, because they say she's going to be like a lawyer representing mafia people. They kind of hint at that. But, you know, it's the women characters are great on the show, and obviously we didn't touch on Adriana. I want to mention that really quickly, because for me it was one of the most shocking moments in the series, even though it had been spoiled for me that she was going to be eliminated by these people. To see it happen is just, and in slow motion, is just sickening. And she's the other Carmela, right? I mean,
right.
She's like the other option for what Carmela's life could be.
Yeah, she is the other option. Although, I mean, she was really okay with that lifestyle, all right? I mean, she was the gangster's girl.
Yes. Yeah, she did want out. Like, but I guess she only wanted out when the FBI offered her a way out, and
right.
She tried to convince Christopher. But yeah, they do portray again other options offered to her, but she couldn't.
That's right, and even up to the point where, you know, Syl's driving her out to the woods, which, I mean, I think the woods in the series itself has a certain kind of symbolic resonance.
Pine Barrens being a particularly rich episode about that. Talk about shamanic, man.
The Frost poem about the snowy woods.
Yeah.
I mean, this is death, right? Again, you know, the specter of death hanging over. She's looking, she's imagining that, what, they're driving to California or something, right?
Yeah, right.
I didn't know that was coming at all, actually.
Yeah.
And that was a real, real shocker.
Yeah, yeah. It's pretty sickening. I remember reading that none of the actors wanted to do it, and they actually, you know, chose Syl, the Stevie, little Stevie is his name? Steven Van Sant.
Yeah.
The Bruce Springsteen's guitarist, who looks nothing like Syl in real life. It's really, really weird. But he was like, I saw an interview with him where he was like, I was like, really, we were all traumatized by it. Like, I really didn't want to shoot that scene, and it was awful.
It's tough to watch.
And the fact that it's tough to watch is really another indication of how powerful The Sopranos was trying to be. I mean, they really wanted to, like, traumatize you a little bit, you know? They really, I mean, they even did it with another great example of how women were employed thematically in the show is when Dr. Melfi's raped.
Yes, Employee of the Month.
Yeah, Dr. Melfi is... raped just randomly, violently by some guy that's in a parking garage, and the way that the different male characters react to it is very, very important, right? Right. Her husband is very much like, "Oh, well, why were you in the parking lot?" And he's basically got nothing but blame for her. But then she's got this other option, which she's talking to Tony, and it's really, really kind of manipulative and beautiful the way they manipulate your view of Tony Soprano in that, because you really want her.
It challenges you.
Yeah, you really want her to say, "I was raped," and go get him.
But
like,
at
you
the same
want
time.
Tony to be unleashed so that Tony can go get revenge on this guy that did this, right?
Yeah.
And I definitely did, and I was like, please, Dr. Melfi, tell Tony so Tony can go, you know, get a blowtorch and a pair of pliers and go medieval on this
right.
guy. But you know, at the end of that episode is him, you know, basically saying, "Do you have something to tell me?" And she just looks and says, "No."
No.
And that's and it goes black in the credits, and it's obviously, you know, communicating this kind of contradiction at the heart of this, right, is that we're watching this guy and we kind of get off on his sadism and his violence, and the show
also,
is telling us like, hey, cool that out, you know?
Exactly.
And like, you need to think about that. It's in the same way that like Kubrick's Clockwork Orange is asking us to consider why we like this shit so much. Like, why do you want Tony to grab a blowtorch and a pair of pliers? What kind of sick person are you?
That's right. And again,
you don't believe in justice. You see that someone's raped, you don't want that person to be tried in civilian court. You see that you want a person,
vengeance.
You want them to be tortured. I mean, I'm hearing it right now with the Boston bombing. People
right.
saying, why do we even have a constitution? Why do we even have civilian court? We should just be executing these guys on the street. And it's like, well, then you don't believe in the American experiment at all. Like, you don't believe in it.
And you are also subject to those same
right.
rules and regulations, which is part of what The Sopranos shows. Like, I mean, even somebody like Dr. Melfi.
Yeah.
Like, she is, in a way, punished for her relationship with Tony, in
yes.
a sense, right?
Yes.
She doesn't come out of this unscathed.
Right.
And so, I mean, it really forces us to think in terms of, like, what is our responsibility?
Yeah.
Can we live without any kind of, you know, historical responsibility? And Melville is obviously going to tell us no.
I mean, the Pequod
at the end is smashed and everyone dies except Ishmael. He's saved because he grabs a coffin.
Yeah.
That was
yeah.
great. But I mean, you know, what's our coffin?
And are
because
we?
Because we're on the boat too. Yeah.
I think there's something about how trapped we are in ourselves and our identities, and how those identities are formed by historical forces.
Absolutely.
And how, and so as a result, we're kind of caught in this limbo where we know we're something else. We know we are our essential soul, or that nugget of being, that real Tony Soprano, the one that cries and loves babies and touches the
horses too,
horses and animals. That real sentimental guy, Tony Soprano, underneath there doesn't get to come out. in America, right?
Yeah.
That's
the tragedy.
That you're trapped within the identity that's created for you, in a sense, that you become who you are not as a result of a deep engagement with what you want to be, but with what external forces create you.
That's right.
When
you scream for vengeance, like, yeah, that's what you're becoming.
Right. Right.
And as we see, like, you know, the gangster is destroyed by that aggression. He's destroyed by the violence that brought him success.
It's heavy shit, man.